Equities extended losses despite a strong start yesterday as the stronger than expected economic data boosted the Federal Reserve hawks. The rising inflation in Europe is also quite worrying as Goldman Sachs now predicts that inflation in Britain would peak at 22% level next year. So welcome, this is Swissquote's daily market talk. Was going well yesterday, equities were in the green when suddenly the dark clouds gathered and it actually started raining in the markets. Well, the biggest catalyzer of yesterday's sentiment reversal in the market was certainly the stronger than expected economic data released in the US, which revived the Federal Reserve hawks and sent equity indices lower in the US session. Because first, the jobs data showed that the job openings in the US spiked above the 11 million level. And that's really too bad for the Federal Reserve because the Fed would actually love to see the job openings decrease so that the company's demand for workers could just cool down without causing too much unemployment. So this is something that would be perfect for the Fed, but that ain't happening, unfortunately. The US jobs market remains extremely tight right now, and there are about 2 jobs waiting for each unemployed worker in the US. Now, of course, not every job fits every worker, as we are not in an economic model or in an economic book, but the job vacancies remain at historically high levels in the US, that's certainly. The layoffs remain low, despite companies announcing to reduce actually their workforce, and Snap being the latest one to lay off 20% of its employees, by the way, and people quitting their jobs. So you know what that means? Well, that actually means that the companies should actually pay more money, higher salaries to get people to work for them. And well, that has an undesirable positive impact on inflation. Hence, it does revive the Federal Reserve hawks. Now, second, the US Consumer Confidence Index jumped in August, and that was the higher than the most optimistic of the forecast that we found on a Reuters survey. So good for you, America, but improved confidence among people also means that people, households, could be tempted to spend more money, which goes against the Federal Reserve's will to cool down demand and ease inflation in the US. So the latter also boosted the Federal Reserve hawks yesterday. And as a result, we saw the S&P 500 slump more than 1% yesterday. The 50-day moving average and the 50% Fibonacci level on the summer rally have been pulled out, and the index closed the session below that 4,000 psychological mark, and that was for the first time in more than a month. Nasdaq slid another 1% as well, and it also cleared its 50-day moving average support to the downside, signaling a stronger bearish momentum for the technology-heavy Nasdaq in the coming sessions. And in both cases, for both Nasdaq and the S&P 500, the technical indicators don't point at oversold market conditions just yet, hinting that the sell-off has perhaps more to deepen in the next few hours of trading. Although the US futures are again in the positive at the time I'm talking here this morning, well, we saw yesterday that the winds could rapidly change direction, and well, the volatility is picking up some momentum to the upside. Now, due today on the data from the ADP report in the US will be one of the key data that investors will be closely watching in the US. The US economy is actually expected to have added some 200,000 new private jobs in the month of August. Now, a stronger than expected ADP figure has power to boost the Federal Reserve hawks, as we saw at yesterday's trading session, and increase the bearish pressure on equities. A softer than expected figure will, however, do little to bring in the Fed dose, given that the Fed wants a tighter jobs market in the US, and it will only be happy to see the number of job additions cool down. And I'm quite sorry to say this, but as long as the jobs market remains this tight in the US and inflation remains the predominant concern for the policymakers, the Fed will actually welcome any further slump in equity prices. Well, the Fed members actually say it loud and clear that they are ready for households and for companies to suffer in the short run to get the price stability right in the longer run. In the sense, the Minneapolis US Fed President Kashkari couldn't be clearer when he said on Bloomberg's Odd Lots that he was not excited to see the stock market rallying after the latest FOMC meeting because he knows how committed the Fed they all are to getting inflation down. And somehow, he said, somehow the markets were misunderstanding that. Yes, they were. The Fed was saying that they will bring inflation down no matter what, and investors wanted to hear, oh, we will cut interest rates if economy in the US is pushed into recession. Oh, well, maybe we should just learn to be better listeners, or I don't know what we could do, but they were quite clear. Now, the US was not the only one shaken by economic data yesterday. In Europe, the German inflation hit an almost 50-year high of 8.8%. Yesterday, the Spanish inflation was slightly off, but still above the 10% mark. Now, the French and Italian will also release their latest CPI updates, and boom, we will get the flash CPI estimate in the Eurozone this morning. And, well, the number is expected to be around 9%. That's a lot for Europe. Now, the European Central Bank's Muller said yesterday that the ECB should discuss 75 basis point hike at its September monetary policy meeting as inflation outlook in the Eurozone has failed to improve. And he is right. There is more pain before relief in Europe when it comes to inflation. For example, in Germany, the latest inflation figure was relatively softish thanks to the government aid, including fuel rebate, for example, but these measures will end soon and it will push inflation higher. The natural gas prices continue spiking, on the other hand, as Russia turns off the Nord Stream 1 for 3-day maintenance, and we doubt that the gas flow will ever be restored again. Gazprom, on the other hand, warned the French utility Engie that it would halt deliveries from Thursday this week because of a disagreement over payments. So if that's not enough for you, the euro also keeps weakening against the US dollar, making the European imports more expensive, and that also pushes inflation higher. And the euro dollar is struggling, obviously, to keep its head above water as the hawkish European Central Bank expectations are being troubled by the recession fears in Europe. Well, across the channel, the situation is not more brilliant, I'm telling you. I will give you two numbers that got my attention yesterday. One is 22% and the other is 170 billion pounds. Let's start with 22%. So if you think that 10% inflation in Europe is excessive, listen to this. Goldman Sachs warned yesterday that inflation in Britain could hit 22% next year if the natural gas prices remain high. Other big banks are not as pessimistic as Goldman Sachs, but the numbers they forecast for inflation are not encouraging either. Citi, for example, sees the British inflation advance past the 18% mark, while the Bank of England itself sees inflation trend to 13%. These scary inflation numbers also mean that the BOE hawks are not sleeping in their corner, but cable is headed toward the 1.15 mark, and that even with the expectation that the Bank of England rates will more than double to 4.25% next year. If that's not capable of giving some strength to the pound, I actually don't know what can. And the second striking number for the UK is the 170 billion pounds, or around 200 billion US dollars. So this is the amount of excess profit that the British gas and electricity producers will be making over the next 2 years, and that according to the British Treasury estimates. So you bet the British policymakers are also willing to get their part of that cake by imposing windfall tax on these companies, as their European counterparts are also preparing to intervene in the energy markets to stop the soaring energy prices. So we are still waiting for more news on this end from the Europeans. In the meantime, the European natural gas futures are down by another 9% yesterday. That's good news, as the price of American crude is to $90 per barrel on global recession worries. And announced this morning, while the Chinese official manufacturer manufacturing PMI rose more than expected, although it remained in the contraction zone for the second straight month, that's below 50, as the factory activity and restricted mobility due to COVID restrictions and the energy crunch due to a historical drought in China led to a second month contraction in activity. And China is only ramping up COVID restriction measures in big cities as cases are reported to go higher. So that's not really encouraging. So this is all for today. I'm İpek Özkardeşkaya and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and it has been insightful to you. So please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions and your questions below as usual and follow us on Instagram, on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates. And subscribe, of course, to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.